of this course. And I mean, the women all called themselves ladies, and the women couldn't do any of the carrying of the buckets because they were ladies. I mean, it was quite a shock to me, because I'd been so involved in this, all this politics, you know. But so I was freaked out, really. And also, it's very traditional Buddhist, this very patriarchal kind of structure coming from Asia, from Tibet. You know, I heard that the nuns sit behind the monks, this kind of thing. So part of me was completely shocked and really struggling with it. But I knew Buddhism was my path. I really felt I found the philosophy that I wanted, but I had to process it. And I remember vividly hearing, you know, that you had to check Buddha's not a creator, so really think about it, don't just leap in, don't just believe in it. And so I figured if there's no logic to it, if it's innately patriarchal, then how can I be a Buddhist? It's not possible, you know. And so I really thought about it, and I really knew it was up to me to check. And I think, and maybe we'll talk about karma today, because I think the thing that really was most powerful for me, I didn't understand any of the words that Lama Zopa said, they were this very arcane, medieval, philosophical structure, and I didn't understand a word, but all at the same time I knew there was something there, and I had to persevere. I remember when I heard about karma, and I think, I didn't know what the word meant, and I asked somebody, they said cause and effect, but something very strongly resonated. And I'd say being a Buddhist all these years, the whole philosophy of karma, Buddhist view about how things come into existence, and the causes of happiness and the causes of suffering, I found very, very powerful. I mean, I know for many Buddhist traditions they don't even talk about karma, but to me this has been a huge one. And certainly, and in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, which is coming from the great Indian tradition of the monastic university system, where they study the philosophy in depth, I find that extremely appealing. I didn't want to, I mean, even the thought of meditating I found kind of boring. It wasn't the point to me. It was more I wanted a world view. I really wanted a world view. I wanted a way of seeing the world, understanding the world. I didn't mean to go the scientific way, so it was politics. And then when I got to the Buddhist one and hearing all the philosophical teachings, the view of karma, I felt, and that's how I feel still, I really wanted a whole view that was coherent and not just kind of a spiritual practice or something. I wanted more than that. I mean, not everybody's like that, but that's really what I wanted. So I found the Buddhist teachings, especially when they're taught in Tibet, especially the tradition that I find in Tibet. Because some of the Buddhists don't do that. I mean, oh, this is kind of the same as here. And they don't do any philosophical teachings at all. They just do lots of practices, you know. That's okay, I'm not complaining. But even in Tibet, there's very many different approaches. But I really want the philosophy. I want to understand the Buddha's view. And it is Buddha's view, actually. This is coherent, I mean, within itself coherent, deeply detailed view of the universe. What is happiness? What is suffering? Who are we? Where do we come from? Which, actually, in a general sense, is all the questions we always ask. We're always asking why this, why that. But, you know, so I really find that very appealing to have an answer. And like I said last night, I mean it seriously, I'm using the Buddhist view for me is my working hypothesis. You know, I find, you know, obviously I'm a healer. I've been doing it for 40 years, so it's obviously my path. But it's ongoing, every day, always studying, always thinking. And every time I teach, that raw little pieces of the puzzle kind of fall into place, you know, do I understand? So that's for me, it's extremely important. And as a basis of practice, too. For me, if the philosophical teachings are just something for the head, then it's a complete waste of time. So for me, it's got to be applied in your daily life. And if it's not, it's like learning a bunch of recipes and then making a cake. It's completely disintegrating rubbish, you know? I mean, people talk about all the scientific views, which are pretty amazing, being answering all the answers of the universe. But my feeling is if the scientific findings don't actually make you a human, better human being, then you can be a genius mathematician, but go on and beat your wife. Or somehow there's something, a big disconnect between these two. So there has to be, for me, an utter connection between the philosophical viewpoints and your experiential. It has to be. If it's not, it's just a waste of time. So that's what I find appealing about Buddhism. I find it is coherent, you know, and it links the emotional and the, hello, how are you, dears? I can't see you there, darling. I can still see you there.
Where's the bathroom? Is this the bathroom?
Just behind.
Oh, that one. Oh,
so, yeah. So maybe we can talk a little bit about karma, I don't know.
I
can also do a little meditation.
I don't know if I've gotten this book. Of course, there's this man, he's a medical doctor.
Oh, very interesting.
He devoted his entire life to
do research.
Yeah, and trying to sort of prove it in the Western.
I bet nobody listens to him.
This is he has hundreds and hundreds of cases, but these are like his 20 years. I think he's passed away, it's all good. But it's actually quite interesting.
It's very good to have these in the West. It's so good.
I can just get
myself.
Thank you.
Medical doctor.
Yeah.
No, so many Westerns have done this kind of research.
He so of course, in, like, I don't know, and he just decided that this was going to be his research.
Oh, John.
He has, like, actually, I heard an anthropologist talk about this.
Yeah.
Like, questioning the way we think of the child.
That's right.
Because if you believe in karma,
yes,
you sort of come up with a radically different view, and so that anthropologist was using his data.
That's
I interesting. I went to a conference, like an academic conference. And so I was kind of curious. I just stuck in the back of my head for a long time, and now that I'm writing fiction, I wanted to use it in my
book.
So
yes.
I bought his book. It's
wonderful.
Quite remarkable, actually.
No, I think it's fantastic.
Yeah.
The people I do research, you know, outside of the Asian view. But I think, yeah, I think it's fantastic.
I mean, you know, he's found people who really have some remarkable memories.
Of course,
and then he's actually tried to, like, corroborate it.
So yes, exactly.
He's, he's, you know, applied the sort of very, as rigorous as you can get scientifically, to try and actually, and he realized that he can only work with little children because once they're, like, past 3 or 5, well, also they've taken in so much.
That's right.
So then you can't, like, prove or disprove, but when they're, like, 3 years old.
But I suppose what he hasn't done, which is the point, is he hasn't probably established exactly what it is that reincarnates. See, that's where I think, now that we're talking about it, let's just sing a prayer first to start the day, okay? Just to sort of set ourselves on the right track. A little prayer of refuge and this little prayer, the one of the altruistic motivation. So we're just going to sit here together for an hour, a couple of, we'll see how long we sit together, listening, thinking about Buddhist teachings. To see if there's some tools we can take to use in our lives to help us develop our marvelous potential to be a benefit to others. Just think of it this way. Sangye charam soke chonam rajan chobaru dagni kyab suchi dagi chonyen gipa sonam ki drola penche sangye drupa sho sangye charam soke chonam rajan Chancho Baruda Nikyap Suchi Dagi Chonyen Gipa Sonam Ki Drona Penche Sange Drupa Sho Sange Charan Sake Chonamra Chancho Baruda Nikyap Suchi Dagi Chonyen Gipa Sonam Ki Drona Penche Sange Drupa Sho. See, I think really, and over the years, I had to teach. You know, like I said, I wish my guru really said I should teach. So, the things that to me that are the essence of all the Buddha's view that are crucial to understand, if we want to understand karma, and to understand karma, you have to understand the mind. And this is where Buddhism is just incredibly articulate. And this is where, as I said last night, this model of the mind, with the epistemological and psychological models of the mind, comes straight from the Hindus. But it's completely hidden to the world. Nobody, I think not even Indians know the history, you know. I mean, people think of Hinduism and they think of, you know, deities and all this, but nobody, the actual study is all there. So it's phenomenal. Like I said, the fundamental findings of these great Indians more than 3,000 years ago about the mind. And where do they get this information? From their own mind itself. That's what's so amazing. It's not neuroscience, it's not the brain, you know. It's actual, this why this concentration technique called known as mindfulness. But it's phenomenal, outrageous, unbelievable, sophisticated, skillful psychological technique that enables you to completely control the berserk cognitive process and go to a more subtle level of your own consciousness, which we don't even posit as existing. It just seems like fantasy in the West. Because that's why they think it's cosmic and mystical and unable to be proved, because it doesn't function according to the brain. You know? That's why in the Christian and Muslim world, the thing you can't see is called a spirit or a soul, you know. So it's immediately mystical. But it's not the Buddha's view. It's the mind. It's just a continuity of the same grosser level. So you've got, even the way they call it in the Vajrayana model, when we talk about gross consciousness, which is conceptuality and our sensory, which does indeed depend upon the brain, you know, and the body. But then you've got these subtle levels. So we do access the subtle level, but that's what we dream. But no, who understands dream mind is kind of weird and strange, isn't it? And even in this model, you go to this very subtle level of consciousness, so this whole way of describing the mind is incredibly articulate, incredibly clear, and it's not the physical, it's the non-physical, it's the actual cognitive process of the mind itself. And that's what Buddhism has to offer. I mean, I'm sure it's still in the Hindu teachings. Most of the people really study it, I don't know. But it's only really studied and yet still in the Tibetan monastic university system. But even among most Buddhists, they don't study it. And it's just a phenomenally clear, intricate, detailed, precise explanation of the entire way the mind works. It's outrageous, you know. The way the mind works, you know, the epistemological model, and the actual contents of the mind. So this is what you do as a Buddhist, you study this. Because how else can you know your own mind if you don't have a basis of understanding it? If you don't have a way to see it, you know, you can... So one of the biggest mistakes, I think, my opinion, the biggest misconceptions about Buddhism and the mind, is that the best people to think of is what you do with your mind is learn to be mindful. So it's simply one of the many mindfulness that's given all this much broader stroke meaning now. But actually in the mind, you know, the Buddhist model, you've got three categories of states of mind, like I mentioned last night. You've got the negative states, which are the neuroses, which are the delusional, distorted, ridiculous, emotional afflictions, which as Christians you would have called sins, and now just the West we call them normal. You understand, even though we know we're crazy when we've got them. But sort of we incorporate them as normal parts of being human. For the Buddha, these are the cause of all suffering, period. And he's found from by using these amazing meditation techniques, when you go to the subtlest level of your mind, the cognitive process, you can unpack and unravel these cognitive processes. And because they're delusional, and because they're misconceptions, you can actually remove them from your mind. So you can't imagine that until you know. If you think of removing something from your mind, you think of cutting a bit of brain out. It's about the best we can do, you know. There's no thing even remotely like that in our culture. So you've got all the negative ones, which are the cause of suffering. Then you've got the positive ones, which are the cause of our happiness, love, compassion, all the virtues, which the Buddha would say are at the core of our being. And then you've got the third category, which are all the other parts of the mind. I like to call them the mechanics, like concentration, memory, mindfulness. All mindfulness is one very specific part of your mind that causes you to not forget what you're doing moment by moment. So if I think, oh, I'll get a cup of tea, and I go to the kitchen, and then I go, oh, what was I doing? That's lack of mindfulness. It's not this, it's got a bigger meaning now, but it's not the precise meaning. It's just one of these many states of mind that underpin all the other states of mind, both the good and the bad. And so this is why Lama Zopa often says, well, thieves need mindfulness. Because you do, you need very good memory to be a good thief. You know, you need really good, be clear to be a good sniper. So it's not a virtue in itself at all. Do you understand what I'm saying? But having mindfulness enables you to practice virtue, because then you can see your mind well. It's a crucial state of mind. So it's such a different way of seeing the mind. It's such a completely different way of seeing. And it's got nothing to do with knowing the brain. Nor has it anything to do with what happened with your child and what mummy did and what daddy did and what your husband did and all these things. It's just you learning to go into your own cognitive process itself and unpacking and unraveling it. And actually, to do it properly with concentration meditation is an incredibly sophisticated job. Most of us won't get concentration, won't get samadhi, you know. And that's the point about, I'd say, the samadhi, which is the state of utter focus, utter concentration, at the subtle level of mind, coming from this technique that Hindus invented. If you saw a person who was in samadhi, they would look like they were dead, because they've gone to the subtle level, you know. And so in order to really understand what reincarnates, which is great, but he's only done half the job, it's okay, it's fantastic, he's done it. But it's to understand what it is that reincarnates. And mostly in the West, the best people can come up with is a soul. Because it seems a mysterious thing. But for the Buddha, reincarnation is not mysterious, it's fact, you know, it's how things are. So it's kind of such a different way of seeing. And there's such a stubbornness among the scientists to even accept the possibility that your mind might not be your brain. So in all those years of incredible findings, and he's shattered, but they discover that it's not the actual mind itself, you know. It's kind of interesting. But, you know, there's this amazing work that's happened the last 20, 30 years, an organisation called Mind and Life. You see their website, mindandlife.org. A bunch of Westerners started inviting His Holiness and some of the best Tibetan Buddhist brains to have conferences with the best thinkers in the West.
Yeah, the neuroscientists.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. An amazing finding that come out of these conferences, a dozen conferences more over the years, they've all been published. And I met many of the Western thinkers who've been involved in this, and they've all been profoundly changed in their own research as a result of having contact with the Dalai Lama. Mm-hmm. And it's really fantastic because it's opened up all these Western thinkers to what would be hidden to the West normally, these amazing Buddhist thinkers coming from the Tibetan Buddhist monastic university system going back to India, you know. It's really very fantastic. And finding way to this fantastic, he's just like, Dalai Lama's into communicating, into putting people together, which is amazing, you know. I think it's very powerful. So, yeah, the two main things, as far as I'm concerned, I mean, you know, I've got to go teaching around the world. always felt, I just felt in my field a fraud sometimes. All I'm talking about is the same thing, the mind and karma. And, you know, and I haven't studied that much, so I can't say I know that much. But for me, it's utterly fundamental. If you want to be a Buddhist, these are the tools you're using. You've got to know the nature of your own mind. Not just in some mystical way. You've got to know what informs who you are from the first second of conception. So in the Buddhist point of view, it's impossible to understand why a pedophile, why Mother Teresa, if you don't understand karma. It's impossible. Because the Buddhist, you know, the materialist view starts from conception, doesn't it? So mummy makes this little baby, out you pop. And that's the best we can do is we do look in the past, but we look into back the physical past of the mummy and the daddy and the grandpa to see the genes and everything, you know, the impact of all that. But the Buddhist view looks back into the past of your own mind, you know. So that it's not possible to understand a pedophile. Or no, I mean, always remember things like, you know, anybody, for example, anybody. It's impossible to understand what makes you who you are unless you understand, you bring in the view of karma. It's crucial to understand as a Buddhist. And of course, it's one of the main tools you use to help understand yourself in your daily life, you know. And also, it's all structured in Buddhist teachings. You know, the Four Noble Truths, which is the first teaching the Buddha gave after he became a Buddha himself, the first teaching he gave, you know, to his previous disciples before he became a Buddha, he gave this teaching called the Four Noble Truths in Varanasi, the apart. So he, you know, the framework of these, is the concept of suffering. So his third one, I like really a lot, his third one is that there is a state, the way they frame it, they say there is a state called the cessation of suffering. It's not a bit abstract. All he's saying is we all possess the potential to be free of suffering. So, I mean, already an interesting concept, but to know what Buddha means, you've got to know what suffering is, which is the first one. So, you know, he outlays really precisely exactly what suffering is. There are three levels of suffering. And then in the second level of truth, which is totally crucial, is what are the causes of suffering. And he lays it out precisely and exactly. And then the third state, you know, is that you can be free of all this, and the fourth one is how to do it. This is a practical presentation of the entire Buddhist path, all his methodology, basically. You know? I think the biggest problem is because we're so caught up, certainly us in the Christian, I mean, certainly the Christian, our, you know, Christian background, and I would even suggest the Hindu, because the Hindu view still asserts, maybe some of the Hindu schools don't know, I don't know enough about it, do assert that there is something there that's equivalent to a soul, and they do talk about there is some source like equivalent to God, whereas Buddha has absolutely no view like that, and that's his main dimension. That's what we diverged from the Hindu position, you know. Because even all the Hindus would say we come from this source. Buddha says not, we come from our own past, in a way. So to understand the Four Noble Truths for a start is a really practical way to understand generally Buddha's whole deal, you know, it's all in there. And so So what he's saying in the Third Noble Truth is that basically that every mind, every person, every mind possessor, I love the Tibetan word for that we translate in English as sentient being. You know, there's trillions of these, not just the humans, animals, spirits, hell beings, gods, so many sentient beings. That all mind possessors, just naturally by definition, being a mind possessor, possess the potential to be utterly free of what's called suffering and its causes. And so where he pins that down in the second noble truth is the causes of suffering. There's two, essentially two. Past karma, which really means action, driven by the second cause, and they subsume down to this one, a deluded state of mind. So for the Buddha, everything comes down to mind. And when you're studying the teachings in more depth, you even hear, and it's literally said to be true for the Buddha, that everything literally is created by the mind. Universes are the result of the karmic actions of trillions of sentient beings, all affecting, you know, the physical world, which is made of the four elements. That there's no concept of creator, there's no concept of somebody up there running the show, that all the sentient beings, individually and collectively, are every millisecond creating our own experiences, literally. So literally for the Buddha, everything comes from the mind, literally. Not just having some cosmic idea, and it's all spelled out in depth. So the causes of suffering are two. Well, first of all, what's suffering? Well, you know, in the first noble truth, there's three levels of suffering. The first kind of suffering is what we all accept as suffering. It's when, basically speaking simply, is when the bad things happen. you know, we forget even about other realms of existence, but even just if we look into this life, the human life, we all know that in a millisecond the bad things happen. We call that suffering. The headache, the sickness, the hubby leaving you, that, you know, the lights being red if you're rushing to work. As soon as our attachment doesn't get what it wants, that's what we mean by suffering. So that's gross suffering, and everybody agrees with that one. Look at the dogs and the ants, deduced by their body language, they don't like it either. Isn't it? So, you know, that's the grosser level of suffering. But that's all we call suffering. Then the interesting take that Buddha has on it, and this is really quite nuanced and quite hard to see, is in the second kind of suffering, he calls it the suffering of change. But this is, you know, and this, what he means by that is what we normally mean by what we call happiness. When the attachment gets what it wants, you know. But the point for the Buddha, why he calls it the subtle level of suffering, is because the good things he is saying, and if we now look to the second noble truth and look at the causes, if we look at the causes of suffering, past karmic actions that leave seeds in our mind that will ripen in the future as these bad experiences, but they're driven by a delusion, a negative state of mind. So these two subsume down to these. The negative states of mind for the Buddha, this first category of these delusional, afflictive, neurotic states of mind, which he happens to have found that we can get rid of, which is the job of being a Buddhist, getting rid of the causes of suffering. But these are the main cause of suffering, but that effectively, in daily life, attachment is the main cause of suffering. And this takes a while to see, because the view we have of attachment, we all use that word, we use it almost synonymously with something good. You're attached to your family, it sounds like a virtue, you know? So the definition that Buddha has is very, very different from how we use it. And it's a multifaceted state of mind. It goes to profoundly subtle levels. And again, it's far more sophisticated in understanding it than we would ever use, ever would have for the way we use that word, you know, attachment. So go just for a second, go back to this negative states, like I mentioned yesterday, there's like this hierarchy of these negative states of mind, and the root delusion, the one that is the source of samsara, the source of suffering in the first place, is known colloquially as ego grasping. So actually it's known, the Tibetan word for it is simply ma-ritpa. It's known in English as ignorance, straightforward, the word ignorance. But the Tibetan word is ma-ritpa, unawareness. And it's this primordial, deeply held, absolutely primordial, deeply held delusion, misconception, neurotic state of mind. But so primordial that we don't even have any view about it in our materialist models of the mind. So primordial. This deeply instinctive, neurotic, mistaken sense of self and of the entire universe, how it exists. And it's known colloquially as ego grasping. So then on the basis of this really neurotic, mistaken sense of self, the main delusion that is, like, I call it like the main voice of this ego, is this one of attachment, which is this, you know, it starts with, we're born with it, the deepest energetic level of attachment from eons of practice of it, Buddha would say, countless past lives, is this huge feel of dissatisfaction. Some people we can see have it far more than others, no matter what they get, no matter what we do, no matter what we have, no matter what we eat, no matter what we see, no matter what we achieve, it is never enough. Like these vampires constantly craving more, you know, like junkie, basically. And it's not joking to call it like a junkie mind. This is the energy of attachment. So naturally what that rises as, because there's this terrible dissatisfaction, it's so instinctive, no one taught us. We're programmed with it from the first second of conception, from countless lives and practice, and that's what I mean. Without understanding the Buddha's view of karma, from the Buddha's perspective, it is impossible to understand what causes a person to be the way they are. Literally impossible. It's like impossible to understand what a person is. Impossible. So we come into this life instinctively, at the time of conception, programmed with this primordial dissatisfaction, which then naturally gives rise to a hankering after something. It's what craving is, the obvious meaning of craving. There's always something missing, so you always want something. And the obvious first level is the objects of the senses, the gross level, the grossest level, you know? And this is the way attachment works every day. It's always like a searching for something, such that when you get it, you're convinced that'll fill me up, that'll fill up the gaping hole. Well, look at us with food, you know? Look at somebody with sex, look at somebody with money, Because somebody with other objects of the senses, utterly addicted, like junkie. So whereas in our culture, attachment in this way is considered normal, as long as it's not out of control. But when it's out of control, it's called a junkie. But it's not kidding. I'm really not kidding when I say that Buddha's saying we're all junkies. It's just a question of degree, and it's a question of the object, that's all. But it's a primordial, across-the-board, delusional state of mind that is the cause of all this dissatisfaction, this pain, this feeling of being fractured and not having, you know, which is the main voice of the deepest delusion, this one called ego grasping, this mistaken sense of a self, mistaken sense of I, so primordial. So then on the basis of attachment, that it's got these multifacets. The first one, like I said, is dissatisfaction. Then, of course, gives us rise to craving something. And then what it does, and this is the key function of all the delusions are the same from one perspective, they distort their object. And when we understand this, and this is very unique to the Buddha's view, we can really see why we suffer, you know? That, so this attachment hugely distorts the deliciousness of certain objects. We all know that. You know, if I'm in love with Fred, we all know he looks totally divine to our eyes. You know, and it looks hugely divine because attachment is grossly exaggerated his deliciousness. When that chocolate cake is sitting there and it looks so divine, what's happening is this attachment in the mind, which is coming from dissatisfaction, which is all this craving, it literally causes the object to look far more delicious than it really is. Which then, you know, but the other part of attachment, and this is what's dealt with in the esoteric teachings in Buddhist Vajrayana, which is coming from the Hindu understanding of the subtle physiology and the subtle psychology, which is dealt with in Buddhist Tantra or the Buddhist Vajrayana, which is the same model the Tibetan doctors use, the Tibetan medical system. It's really interesting. But this attachment, which is kind of in the body, linked to these subtle wind energies, the prana. So one of the functions of attachment, which is why it throws us so hugely, it triggers extremely good feelings in the body. So when the feelings in the body are extremely nice, this is part of the process of why the cake or Fred looks so delicious. And because the feelings are so delicious and Fred looks delicious, of course you're completely convinced that he's the cause of happiness. Because you're feeling so fantastic, and it has to be Fred. It has to be the chocolate cake. It has to be the new handbag. It has to be whatever it might be out there. You know? So it's really subtle how this attachment works. So naturally, because you're dissatisfied, because you're hankering, and then you find Fred, and he looks divine, and there are good feelings, naturally you've got to have it. I mean, everything is pointing to Fred being the cause of all my happiness, which is exactly what we think in the world. And Buddha says it's a total lousy lie. It's completely mistaken. So you have to do all this analysis and all this energizing and all this looking and all this logical analysis and indeed much purification in order to be able to see how it's a lie. Not just vaguely feel it's a lie and feel guilty because you've got attachment, but to really understand logically. And you can't do that until you study Buddhist psychology. It's not possible. It's just not possible, you know. It's there, it's described in the literature in great detail exactly how it functions, how it exaggerates the deliciousness of an object. And so because, and even more profound for the Buddha, is his view that this world we live in, he calls it a desire realm. The word desire is equivalent to the word attachment. But this is a desire realm. So what he means by this is, so, you know, it's not how we think in the West. God, so different. And again, it's similar to the Hindu view. Eons ago, because you know, the Buddha's also, because he's not a creator, there's no first cause. The world were all wanting a first cause. Even one time I remember the Dalai Lama saying the Big Bang. He says, Big Bang? No problem. Just not the first Big Bang, that's all. Because even in science, what the first cause of everything, it's kind of fascinating. Buddha says, what do you want a first cause for? But that's where the Christian teachings, the Hindu teachings, the Muslim teachings, any of the religions that support, that posit a creator, everything goes back to that. That's the first cause. And of course, if you're a naughty kid at school, you'll ask, well, who caused God? He's told to be quiet, you know. God doesn't have a cause. Well, Buddha says that's not on. It's not on. You don't need a first cause, he says. Because, and this is where it's so shocking, he would say, consciousness, my mind, your mind, even material, even matter, are their beginnings. Which is an insane view. I mean, but why is it insane? It's just, I mean, we're convinced there has to be a first moment. There's not a single logical, rational reason for why we think there has to be a first moment. Buddha says it's a misconception coming from this ego grasping, from our delusions in our mind, which are what causes, he says, to create the idea of a creator. We've created the idea of a creator, he says. So anyway, he says, this consciousness of ours, think of it like a river of mental moments in Buddhist psychology. They also have the term mental continuum, you know? Have you taken a copy of your records?
Oh, I said, well,
where?
What's that?
Okay. How many? Oh, I look at that. If I were the fans, it works, then. Doesn't matter. I'm just asking. So, anyway, think of your mind. Yeah, they use the term mental continuum. So, if you think of your mind, one way to say, like an analogy, is a river of mental moments. Technically, it's not true, because this second of your mind is only all that's existing. The last second is gone, and the next second hasn't come yet. But it's not actually like that, but think of it as a river of mental moments, you know? And we know if you had perfect memory, you could track your mind back, right back to the second you popped into your mummy's womb at the time of conception. And that's what Buddha says you began, when your mind went into that egg and sperm, and that's what caused them to begin to develop into you, you know? So then you think, well, where did I come from the previous moment? What about the previous moment before conception? Well, the egg was in mummy's body, we know that. The sperm was in daddy's body. But your consciousness came from a previous moment of this continuity. So this moment of mind necessarily has its source in the previous moment. And where does that have its source? In the previous moment. And where does that have its source? In the previous moment. And where does that have its source? In the previous moment. And you keep going back, and you, by definition, cannot find a moment that didn't have a previous moment. So conclusion, your consciousness is continuous. But for the Buddha, so too is the universe. You know, the physical world for the Buddha is made of the four elements. Certainly in the Vajrayana model, it's made of the four elements, just like we used to think in the Western model, you know, back at the time of Galileo. It's made of the four elements, this physical world. But if you think back, if there was a moment when this universe began, the one that we know here now, this planet and everything, but it has to have come from some previous energy of those four elements, you know. These four elements subsume down to the wind element, the subtlest one. And then there's this fundamental building block called the wind element, which Buddha also says is indestructible and is beginningless. So he says you don't need creator. And the creative principle, if you like, is actions of mind. The Dalai Lama often says it's like self-creation. Meaning, that's why we have to understand karma, so I'm talking about both mind and karma here. But they're so linked because karma plays out in the mind, nowhere else. It's not some abstract thing up there, you know. So what karma means? Well, first of all, the word apparently means action in Sanskrit. But the real meaning, the real essential, actual, experiential meaning is the word intention, thought. A thought, intention, I will, volition, will. This is the fundamental meaning of the beginning of the process of cause and effect or karma. It starts with the mind. It starts with the mind. So every millisecond, Buddha is saying, our mind, every millisecond, is constantly doing something, and therefore constantly, quote-unquote, creating karma. Because every millisecond of every thought, Buddha says, like we mentioned yesterday, does not go astray. It stays imprinted in the mind, and it's leaving a seed that will, like a seed, bring results in the future in that mind. Whether it's now or in a lifetime or a million years, in this continuity of the mind. There's no thought or mental action that goes astray. Buddha says this is the way it is, you know. So therefore, everything we've ever done and said before is programmed in our mind, is there. And of course, because the Buddha says everything that in the mind can be known, this is why they say the end result of this process, the word Buddha, one of the qualities of a Buddha is omniscience, literally knowing that which exists without mistake. Buddha says it's just the nature of mind. It's the nature of mind. It's just the mind, how it is when the mind is completely, the pollution is utterly gone. What is left is pure, unmanifest, all-knowing, all-pervasive consciousness. Yeah. Buddha says it's just the nature of mind. And it can necessarily cognize that which exists. So everything we ever think and do and say is programmed in our mind. So we come into this life from the first second of conception, programmed with all the millions of seeds that will then produce our life. And it's divided into four ways. So, you know, not many weeks before we went into our mother's womb, at the time of our past death, before we even stopped breathing, and the way we die in Buddhism is really important because that then determines what karmic seeds are triggered, which are the ones that will then throw you, as they say, into the next life. So in our case, being human, we can deduce that, you know, not long before we stopped breathing, a very powerful, virtuous karmic seed, in particular the karmic seed of the practice of morality, in particular the practice of refraining from killing others, as well as other virtuous seeds nourished by that, a very powerful virtuous karmic seed of morality was triggered by the way we died, which then is the one that would cause us, in our case, to go to our particular present mother's human womb. That was triggered even before we stopped breathing. Well, simultaneously, all the other millions of karmic seeds that would then produce our personality. What our personality is has zero to do with our parents. Well, not zero. They're a condition. But the actual tendencies to be Hitler or Mother Teresa, you know, whether you've got tendencies to be a brilliant musician or a good footballer or a psychopath or a saint, they're all yours. They triggered even before you stopped breathing in the past life, at the same time as this main cause that would give Robina this particular life, in this life to that particular money. All the personality traits are also there, all those seeds are triggered. The next set of seeds that are triggered are the four ways our karma ripens. The first one is the type of rebirth, in our case human, which is the fruit of virtue. The second way our karma ripens is all our tendencies, our personality traits, good and bad, you know. They're all triggered at the same time, they'll become our personality. The third lot are called experiences similar to the cause. And what that means is, it determines even the very parents we're born to, whether they're good parents or bad parents, whether they love us or hate us, whether they're poor or rich, whether they beat us or abuse us or rape us or give to us or kind to us, whatever, and then our siblings and our neighbours and everybody, up until we die, all the sentient beings we come across, you know, the dogs that we love, the cockroaches that, you know, put caca in our spoon drawer, the rats that eat our house, the rapist, the beloved person who's kind to us, all the sentient beings and how we're seen and treated by them. This is called experiences similar to a cause. All of those seeds for all of those experiences are triggered at the time before we even stop breathing in a past life. And the fourth set of seeds were triggered. It's called environmental karma. It's the very way the physical world impacts upon us. So you can be born into a very beautiful country where the water is very sweet, the air is not polluted, it's very peaceful, there's no violence. That's the fruit of unbelievable virtue. You can be born into a country that's the opposite. That's the fruit of non-virtue. So all the way the very physical world impacts upon us and our health, and whether food harms us or helps us, all the way sentient beings treat us or see us or like us or don't like us, or even including starting with our parents, all our own tendencies, all our own personality traits, and our very humanity itself. So literally, what it says, we are the creator of who we are. And this comes to the dogs, the ants, the humans, the hell beings, the gods. There's all the sentient beings are naturally run, are living according to this natural law. What it says, it's a natural law. He didn't make it up. Nobody's running it. It's a natural law like gravity or botany. It simply runs the universe, what it says. So he says, we just don't need a boss. We don't need a creator. And in the same way, that same philosophy of there being a creator, a big boss, his point is, we don't need a little boss in here that we think is in there, which is the self that runs the show. It's the same philosophy. The philosophy that says there's a creator that runs the universe is the same philosophy of the self-existent I that we all believe is in there running the show. It's the same view. And this Buddha says it's a complete mistake philosophically. Our minds have made it up. This is a function of his ignorance. So the law of karma for the Buddha is, a natural law. It runs the universe. It plays out in sentient beings' minds. So clearly, if I want to understand myself, I have to understand the law of karma. That's kind of obvious, if I'm a real Buddhist. Because what I've done in the past informs my present. How can it not? It's so obvious, you know? So knowing about karma and understanding the cause, for the Buddha, this law of cause and effect, it's the same principle as any law of cause and effect. You know a rose, you need to put this together, that together, this together. You get a rose every time, you know it's a natural law. Well, the same here. Buddha says the natural law, what produces happiness and what produces suffering. And so, negative actions, he would say, which is an action of, first, is of the body and speech that harms another that is informed by a delusion. That's the cause of suffering. That could ripen as a being born as an animal. That could ripen as a negative tendency to keep doing that action. It would ripen as that action happening to you, the experience, or it would ripen in an environmental way. So to use the one example of, say, a virtuous action called non-killing, which is an intentional, everything has to be intentional to be a proper karma. If there's no intention, there's no karma. You know, my foot can stand on an ant, and the ant dies a terrible death. I created no karma at all. How could I? My mind was not involved, because karma has to start with the mind. If there's no mental involvement, there's no karma. There can't be. It's just illogical. Again, it's quite complex and quite nuanced, but one has to learn it if one wants to apply it to one's daily, use it to apply to your life, to interpret your life. So if we take one action of, say, conscious, not intentional, non-killing. So let's, you know, there's that mouse in my kitchen, and I see it, and I don't want to hurt it, and I intentionally, oh, I must not harm the mouse, and I release the mouse and throw it out, then that's called an intentional action of non-killing, and that shows a really powerful seed in my mind. So that will eventually ripen in any of four ways. If it keeps growing, it'll one tiny seed brings many fruits, so that would ripen as many happy rebirths, like human birth, for example. Probably only one human birth. That was the throw-in karma, they call it, the complete karma. Second way that intentional non-killing would ripen as a habit to not kill. I'd wake up in this life with a habit to not kill. The third one would be, I will not get killed. I will live a long life, or I won't die young. And fourth, my body will be healthy, the food will nourish me, and I'll have not a harmful environment. That's the fruit of non-killing. Equally, the fruit of killing, I'd be born in the lower realms, or if I'm born as a human as a result of virtue like us, I'd have a tendency to kill. Look at the world, most people kill something because of having killed in the past. I'd have the experience of being killed, or I'd die young. Look at the world. And I'd have the environmental result of getting sick, having a weak body, the food, the water being polluted, the peanuts being, having an allergy, that's the environmental karmic result. So the Buddha would say the entire environment, the four elements have no power for their own side. They're inert. What causes the elements to manifest in the universe over the eons of time is the collective actions of the sentient beings who occupy it. It's mind and actions of the mind that impact upon the elements. And this is described in great detail in the Vajrayana teachings, where because we have this intimate relationship between the elements in the body and our mind, they impact upon each other. What I was mentioning last night for you, you were asked about medicine Buddha. So this Buddha says that this realm we're living in right now is a desire realm, meaning it's literally the product of attachment. So he would say, eons ago, before this human planet, this time is beginningless, a human birth actually was a really high birth where the mind only had access to virtue. There were no non-virtues. All these delusions we have, they're basically, for the Buddha, they're animal activities. Because we're in such degenerate times now. But would have been just access to virtue, and because the physical energies, all the wings and everything, were so subtle, and there was so much virtue, we basically had subtle light bodies. This is eons ago, before this planet. But gradually, like a karmic evolution, if you like, the imprints of desire and the delusions and ego were all there, although they weren't manifesting, because virtue was manifesting. But gradually, these began to manifest, and then as time went by, it became more degenerate, more degenerate, more degenerate, and all these delusions began to manifest. They polluted all our wind energies, polluted the physical elements, and eventually we get born on this planet looking like a bunch of apes, So for the Buddha, it's a really degenerate time, like a really, really degenerate time. We're looking around like a bunch of apes with all these animal activities, animal tendencies, like attachment, anger, rage, craving sex, craving food. It's like, heavy duty, like basically animal qualities. But our saving grace is our virtue. Our saving grace is our virtue, our morality, our goodness, our wish to practice the spiritual path. How fortunate, how fortunate. So this then desire, basically attachment, has drives us. Look at this body, what else is it? It's, basically it's a walking desire machine. five senses that, and then attachment in the mind is this rampant, raving junkie that craves to satisfy these poor, demented senses. Look at this, isn't it? And what is the physical world? There's the five senses, isn't it? So we're born as a junkie. This is really what the suffering is about. Okay. There's three kinds of suffering. The first kind is the suffering of suffering. So using this analogy of being a junkie, the gross suffering is when attachment doesn't get what it wants. It's like, we go nuts. The second kind of suffering, which is what we call happiness, which is when attachment does get what it wants, that's like the honey-covered razor blade. It's like when you get the junk. But the Buddha says, this is why he means this, is called the suffering of change. It doesn't last. We know that, but we don't join the dots. We know it doesn't last. But not just it doesn't last, where does it go? So, we're convinced if you're attached to cake, the suffering is not getting the cake, right? That's the first kind of suffering. But then you get the cake, you think that's the happiness, but you get the cake, And initially, it does trigger really nice pleasure. But we're going to ask that question, why we have to have another beast. The stomach's probably more than content. But guess what isn't content? It's our mind. Because dissatisfaction, attachment, is a bottomless pit. And it cannot be satisfied by cake. We don't get that because we're junkies. So, of course, it's so exciting and so delicious. Before we even know it, the next mouthful goes in, isn't it? It's actually, the first mouthful is probably the best. But it goes downhill from there. Because we want more of it. We don't know how to retain it. So we have to put the cake in again. And then we do know, it's true, as a point comes where you know by now you're really distressed. The stomach is stuffed. your pleasure has faded. But you're still not satisfied. And this is this terrible suffering of attachment. I always remember one of those programs, you know, where people would have these programs about extreme examples of like obesity, for example. There's one little American girl, I'll never forget. She's like 600 pounds, this little girl, they're young. And the way her mother said it was so poignant, but so profound. She said, oh, she's always been like this. She never felt full. It's clearly got nothing to do with the stomach, you know. Feeling full means satisfied. But we're not satisfied. This is the suffering of being an attachment. This is the suffering of being a junkie. We're never satisfied. And that's the point. We can see it. This is the tragedy of attachment, Bruce says. The utter tragedy of attachment. It's this junky mind. And it can never be satisfied by the object of the senses. It can't be. It just can't be. It's not possible. I mean, we all can see it. It's like running our lives. So that's the second kind of suffering. It's sort of obvious. And what does it lead to? A stuffed stomach, which is the first kind of suffering. So the second kind of suffering, which we think is happiness, leads inexorably to the first kind of suffering. So it's like this terrible track we're in. Then the third kind of suffering is even more abstract. But I like to call it all pervasive suffering. But I like to describe it like this, using the analogy of being a junkie. The suffering of suffering is when you don't get the junk. It's like a nightmare. The suffering of change is when you get the junk. But the all pervasive suffering is being born in the first place in a body created by desire, in a world created by junk that you have to ingest just to survive. That's all pervasive suffering. You know? So it's like there's no choice. So to go beyond this is unbelievable. Incredibly subtle. Incredibly beautiful. So without understanding karma, without understanding the mind, you can't really say you're Buddhist. I mean, I'm not being rude here. You know? What I mean is this. To really use the tools of Buddhism to really achieve the goal he says we can, which is the cessation of all suffering. Which is meaning you've got to have samadhi, which means you've got to practice morality first. You can't possibly get samadhi if you can't control your body, speech, and mind and practice morality, which is massively difficult. Because only the person with incredible levels of morality, which is the person who's gone beyond so much level of attachment that they're already blissful, that's the person who can get samadhi. The person who gets samadhi has then accessed this subtle level of their mind, which they've studied in depth, and now they can do the job of unpacking and unraveling at the subtlest degree all these elaborate cobwebs of stories, all of them, which are the delusions, which Buddha says are adventitious, which we can get rid of. It's a phenomenally sophisticated job. Until eventually uproot the root delusion, ego grasping, with the realization of emptiness, the realization of selflessness, and then practicing that for countless lives, or many lives, or however long it takes, in order to finally, combining it with bodhicitta, become a Buddha, you know, or indeed achieve your own nirvana, which is the first stage of development. There's this nice packaging teachings that all the Tibetans kind of refer to. It's known, certainly in our tradition, the Gurukulas, it's known as Lam Rim, which is this term that's translated literally as path, gradual path. But if you use a modern day term for this, it's the word a course. It's a course. And we know a course, you start at grade one, you go to grade two, you three, grade four, and then you graduate. Well, that's literally the meaning of this Lam Rim. And what it is all the Buddhist teachings presented really nicely in a coherent package, you know. And the teachings are all there to be internalized according to the capacity of the students, like any course, you know. And so the first two sections of this, and they use the term, the teachings of the first scope, which I prefer to use as junior school. I mean, the Dalai Lama often says this, it's like the education system. So the first stage is a practice, junior school, and the second stage is practice, high school. That's the Another analogy in Buddhism, the Mahayana uses, is a word that means two wings, wisdom and compassion. So the whole wisdom wing, that's the Buddhism of, that's the Theravada Buddhism. That's the path that gets you to nirvana. That if you graduate in high school, you've achieved your own nirvana. You've done the job under set. Controlled your body and speech, lived in morality, done lots of practice, get your samadhi, have studied the mind, gone into the mind, removed the delusions, realized emptiness, perfected that realization, and in that particular life, you've achieved your own nirvana. So then if you're on the Theravada path, you would die and not come back. But if you're on the Mahayana path, because your motivation is bodhicitta, you want to add bodhicitta's release, which is like the compassion wing, the bodhisattva path, that's like you go to university. So even though you might achieve emptiness, you don't need to get reborn, you will choose to be reborn to then add on to it the bodhisattva path, so you need to become an enlightened being, a Buddha, so you can be reborn again and again and again and again to then the sentient beings. But in the teachings of Buddhism, actually, there are quite a few different interpretations. I think the Theravada teachings would say that when you finally achieve your own nirvana, when you die, you disappear completely. Whereas the Mahayana says your mind is endless, so it's quite a different teaching than the teaching, quite a different view.
Thank you.
Sorry, that's a summary. Any questions for that?
Yeah. So the third suffering,
All pervading
suffering. Is that samsara? That's samsara?
All of it's samsara, but it's all of it's samsara. All of it is samsara. But we'll put it this way. If we understand the causes... Okay, put it another way. There's another way of framing these three kinds of suffering is in terms of the different realms of existence. I was referring to it here as just within the human realm. We could do it this way. But if you think of it from the whole universe, all of samsara, for the Buddha, you've got the lower realm, which is the result of suffering, the born as a hell being, or as a spiritual animal, that's the gross suffering. Then you've got the second level of suffering, which is the suffering of change, which is human and gods, where there is some happiness, but it's kind of brazen, but it's happiness, doesn't last. And then you've got the subtle level of formless beings, which is the subtlest one, but which is all in samsara, but the different levels of suffering. It's even more subtle, which for the Hindus is the end result. Like which for the Buddha, until you realize emptiness, you're still in samsara. So they're all the realms of samsara. So you can put it this way. You want to stop the first kind of suffering, including in this life, you have to stop harming sentient beings. That stops the gross kind of suffering, including the lower realms. If you want to stop the second kind of suffering, which is the suffering of change, you've got to be on attachment. If you want to stop all this third one and all the suffering altogether, you've got to realize emptiness. You understand?
So now if you do harm sentient beings, if you've already done it, all right. So what is the antidote of that? What is
four abundant powers? Purify. There's no karma. Okay. If our minds are beginning this, which sounds insane to us, and if we have created countless trillions of countless karmas, and if we're lugging around all those countless karmic seeds, which Buddha says we are, but they can't go astray, then the very first level of practice, junior school level, is like I mentioned briefly last night. You've got to back off and stop harming sentient beings. First level of practice. First one, stop harming sentient beings. But then, to add to that practice, you've got to not just do that, you've got to now purify all the seeds you've already planted before they ripen. So it's sort of like, you've got this, you know, the first thing is stop growing the weeds, but you've got to pull out the weeds you've already planted. That's purification. Because there's no karma you can't purify. You've got to do that. It's a major part of practice. And as long as Zopa said, we're insane not to do that practice every day. I'm not strange. Do you understand? That's crucial. Absolutely crucial. So the first level of practice
of purification.
No, the first level of practice, junior school. Refrain from harming others, but even better, merely okay, this is where now vows come in. Let me talk about vows. This is said to be incredibly important. And it's in all the Buddha's teachings, coming from Lord Buddha, right from Lord Buddha. He gives incredible power to living in a vow, not to a vow of morality. So the difference is this. First of all, Buddha says, it's in the Buddha's teachings there somewhere. A person living in vows of morality, and I'll explain what that is. Vows have this subtle physical form, it's visible to clairvoyance, it's something so potent. Living in other words, committing yourself for the rest of your life that I will not kill, I will not lie, I will not steal, I will not cheat on my partner, I will not this or whatever. And so the very first set of vows in this first level of practice are the five lay persons' vows. So the difference, Lama Zopa says, between a person who merely doesn't kill, you know, is a nice person, but merely doesn't kill, but not in the context of a vow, and the person who doesn't kill in the context of keeping a vow is just so phenomenal you can't believe it. Because, and this is the reason, according to karma. He said, you have a person who practices day and night, but isn't living in a vow not to kill. Another person merely keeping their vow not to kill. The second person creates infinite more virtuous karma and purifies their mind infinitely more than the first because of the power of vow. So a vow is this. So, you know, here we are sitting in this room right now. We're not killing, right? We're being nice people, isn't it? But we're not, unless we're thinking, I will not kill. Remember vow's intention? There's no intention right now, right? So it was we're not creating the karmic seed in the mind of intentional non-killing. Karma has to have intention. But there's no intention not to kill. So we're not creating any virtuous karma of non-killing. All the rats are very happy with living in peace. We're creating zero virtuous karma. We're resting on our laurels from the past. You see the difference? It's phenomenal. And the only way to understand this is to understand the meaning of karma, which is intention. Every millisecond, there's always something going on, and every one of those is sowing seeds all the time, and it's a million times a minute, you know? So that's why we have to have control over our minds and know the karma we want to create, because that's what produces us. So we have, like, living in a vow of not killing. Lama Zopa puts it this way, and this is the Buddha's teachings, that when you have consciously, intentionally, like, knelt down in front of somebody who represents the Buddha for you, who got the vows from their person, and you can track it back at a power source right back to the Buddha, it's really Rinpoche, this kind of series of this lineage of vows. So then when you sit down and you vow, I will never kill, I will never, you know, for the rest of my life, you put into your mind this vow, which has this subtle form, if you keep it purely every day. It's said to be so stupendous, you know? And so that, every second, Lama Zopa says, it was Buddha's teaching, it's 24 hours a day, but you're keeping that vow purely, when you're asleep, not thinking about not killing, you're constantly purifying your life, and you're constantly getting virtue. So he would say it's like insane not to live in vows. It's the easiest way to create virtue. And there's nothing about, it takes time to hear this. Because it sounds sort of very materialistic, talking about sowing seeds, practicing virtue, accumulating virtue. You know, we have this very vague notion, I think, in the West, just being a nice person. And we think it's enough. But why we're a nice person is because we've created virtue in the past. We're just resting on our laurels, you know? How come we are a nice person now? How come we have nice virtues now? It's because we have probably vowed in the past. I mean, there's a friend of mine, for example. Okay, I'll give you an example. Two kinds of examples.
I can lock it.
It's okay. I'll be right. I'm okay. So there's this two examples. There's this friend of mine who's a Buddhist, and her little boy, when he was three, he's like 40 now. She said, she was taking the lice out of his head one day, and he's crying with compassion for the lice. Mommy, mommy, don't hurt them. Leave them alone. Stay home. Doing everything she could. He couldn't stop him having the lice. Well, excuse me, he's three. She had not taught him anything. So where the hell does this come from? You know, karmic imprints. So you can deduce logically. He not only had an imprint not to kill, but he would have kept vows of not killing. Strong vows, so much so that he comes into this life with this program to not kill. In just the same way, another friend of mine talked about her boy when he was like three or four. The moment he met fishing, he fell in love with fishing. And he became a professional fisherman until the day he died. So what happened there was, the Buddhist view would be, we could deduce he'd been in the lower realms in the past lives, finish that karma of killing. Then that ran out, and then like a miracle, one of his virtuous karmic seeds ripened at the time of his past death. He could have been an animal. The human karma ripened. He gets born to this really nice mummy in California. He's got lots of nice tendencies, you know, but one of his tendencies is to kill. Nobody taught him. It's an imprint right there, an instinctive imprint right there. Because why? Because he didn't purify. That's the point. So he used up his karma in the lower realms. The main karma result of killing his lower realms. That finished. But because he hadn't vowed not to kill, the residual result of killing is you're born into this life of intensive killing. And look at the world. Most people kill something. Most people kill creatures, ants, and dogs. Who will kill? Because we've been in the lower realms in the past, Buddha says, this is for you. And we haven't purified by vowing not to kill again. This is the tragedy. So this little boy, she didn't like killing. She couldn't stand it, but she wanted to be respectful to him. He just literally fell in love with killing. With fishing, which is called killing, of course. But because fishing is acceptable, no one thinks he's a monster. And mean, if you went around killing poodles, can you imagine how we would have been seen? A monster. But, you know, poodles, fish is different, isn't it, for our culture? So the point is, this one, he had lots of good tendencies. He had lots of good experiences similar to the cause. He was seen as a nice boy, people loved him. He had good environmental karma. He had all these good virtuous karmic imprints, environmental, experiential, and tendencies, but he had a tendency to kill. So this is how attachment works, mixed with karma, and this is the tragedy. This is samsara. There he is in the human body with attachment in the mind and the wish to be happy. There he is with a karmic imprint to kill, and the karma ripens, he sees the fishing. Instantaneously, it triggers the karmic imprint, and instantaneously, it triggers attachment, which makes him feel incredibly nice and makes the fishing look totally divine. So it's like he fell in love with it. So because it looks divine, because attachment made it look divine, and because he feels good, like the chocolate dragon, like Fred, he deduces logically the fishing must be the cause of happiness. So he keeps doing it. This is how attachment mixes with karma. If he didn't have a karmic imprint, he wouldn't have noticed fishing. I saw fishing, my daddy went fishing, I didn't like fishing. I had no attraction to fishing because I must have had a vow not to kill in the past. I mean, this is why we've got to live in vows. We've got to at least now set ourselves up for the next life to not kill. The next life you'll be born with no intention to kill. So for him to go against that impulse would be very hard because it looked delicious, it felt delicious, the world accepted it, so he didn't have a bad reputation. But he happened to have the karma to kill hundreds of thousands of sentient beings. And no one called him a monster because fishing is acceptable. You understand? And this is the tragedy. So he never ever was called on his killing. He didn't ever think of it as wrong. And this is the interesting point. His mother always, she'd said he always, this is the end of the story as well, I'll tell you the end. His mother always couldn't bear to go fishing, but she didn't want to criticize him because she didn't like suffering. But he always asked her to go fishing with him. So one day she went and she found it unbearable. Why? Is because they both are looking at the same thing. Fish in the boat, flapping their bodies. For her, she found it unbearable because she could see nakedly they were suffering. There was nothing in between her and the fish, which was sheer compassion. But he had his attachment. So his attachment, this is what the delusions do, they wrote another story in his mind that he projected onto the fishing, and he called it good. So he was as blind as a bat. He couldn't ever see suffering. This is the suffering of attachment. It's so subtle. I remember even watching on the television one time. One of these, like an Inuit, Eskimos, you know, when they bash the baby seals to death. So he was in tears when these mean animal liberation people criticised him for hurting the seals, you know. He said, but this is our culture. This is what we do. There he was, bashing the baby seal. Anybody with half a brain to see the baby seals are happy, squealing. I mean, fish don't squeal, they die quietly. No blood comes spurting out of fish. But this baby seal, everybody can see it. But he literally couldn't see it because he had the karma from the past and, of course, the karma to harm brutally, and he's born into a culture where it's acceptable. He never sees his causing suffering. This is the tragedy of attachment. This is the tragedy of attachment. Because it's like a person who's a pedophile. We'd love to criticize them, but their delusion is so intense, his attachment to jumping little girls and boys, their attachment to sex, in other words, is so stupendous. It fills their mind the whole time. Look at our attachment to plenty of food. You're attached to food, you think of it all the time. That's one of the signs of attachment. You think of the object when it's not there. So that's what a pedophile does. I mean, you can see their poor slimy faces, you know, because they're thinking day and night about sex. So the fisherman, he's thinking day and night about fishing. His whole life was, it's almost as if he'd taken a vow to kill. He determined himself as a fisherman. He defined himself as a fisherman. He defined himself as a person who kills others. His whole life was based on being a fisherman. All his time schedule, what he did, his money, everything he did. So it was like he took a vow to kill. It was like the opposite. My karma works.
But how do you stop that in someone else then?
You can't, except to lock them up or help them see it themselves. That's the tragedy. Just a second, let me finish the story. I'll finish the story first. This is a tragedy. But understanding it is the first thing. That means we can understand ourselves. Why we're so attracted to certain things. And this is one. Okay, something else. So anyway, the point is this boy. It's quite a tragic story. I met her in the 90s. She was at Kopan Monastery, Namazovas Monastery. She just heard a teaching about karma. She came to my room in tears, you know, telling me about her beautiful boy. The point is, he died 5 years before, scuba diving, because like all fishermen, they don't kill out of hate. They love fish. And he loved going scuba diving, and he drowned scuba diving. So there he was. He had the tendency to kill from having killed in the past, but he hadn't purified it by vowing not to kill. So he wakes up in this life with a very powerful intention to kill. kill. Second, he meets it when he's very yucky. And so he has, and the other tragedy is this. I went fishing one time to impress a boyfriend. No fish came to my life. He kept calling in the fish because I didn't have any karma with sentient beings. There were no sentient beings at that time where karma would be killed by me. But this boy had hundreds of thousands of fish running with their mouths open to his bait or whatever it was, you know. So he had powerful karma with these sentient beings who'd harmed him in the past to be killed by him. So of course he calls himself a successful fisherman. But he hadn't caught fish, he wouldn't have gone fishing. You know? This is the other tragedy. All the fish, they created the cause to run to his hook, run to his nets. So then what happened is he dies, scuba diving. Well, that's the karmic result of killing, called experience similar to the cause. You die young. You probably got killed by the fish, who knows? And then anyway, she said, where was he reborn? I said, well, I don't know. Go and ask this particular lama, who's this amazing yogi, you know. Yeshe, Lama Concho, one of our lamas. He spent 30 years up in the caves, naked. Lama Zopa said he lived in Vajrayogini's Pure Land, this amazing holy being. Really humble, like an old grandpa, you know. He was amazing, special holy being. Anyway, he was a proper monastery. You know, he's highly realized, clairvoyant, all these things. So she went to him, and she said, where's my son reborn? And he thought of it, and he said, kind of, I'm not kidding you, kind of accessed his Google, because clairvoyance is his ability to see exactly what's going on wherever you feel, if you have that realized. Because all, the Buddha says everything's knowable. The universe is knowable to minds. You know? That's what he says. That's what he says, omniscience is what we can accomplish. So he said, first of all, he was born in the animal realms, but now he's in the hell realms. It's not funny. But it's not funny. She kind of, oh, what will I do for him? She said. And he kind of laughed sadly and said, what do you mean for him, for everybody? She's not a Buddhist, I saw her years later, but she said she was very moved by that somehow. And they never tell you what they see in these eyes. Very interesting. Never. But somehow she said it was very powerful from the mind. Not that. This is the right karma, what the Buddha says. And this is what that negative karma meant. She talked about positive karma as well. So, yeah, you had a question.
So, in the Buddha's teachings, what does Buddha say about fear, doing negative actions in a fearful mind. Like, so for example, you really don't want to harm, you don't want to kill, mm-hmm. right? But you come across, say, a snake, and it's you, the snake, and the stick.
And
you get scared, you beat the crap out of it, you kill it, and then you say, shit, this is stupid, you know, I didn't mean to do that, but I got scared. Then what?
That's a negative action, heavy negative action. So, we have to analyze the word negative action. Let's go to look at the components of an action and what determines whether it's negative or positive. It's very clearly laid out. It's really crucial for us to understand this, you know, because given that every second we're creating karma. So, an action called killing, or indeed, we can just as discuss the action called non-killing, it's just the same. We'll go to the component, but in order for an action, let's say killing, to be what they call a complete action, which will sow a seed in the mind that will then keep getting bigger and bigger, multiply, and will ripen as many suffering rebirths. One seed brings many fruits. We'll go in the opposite direction there. It's important to hear about the good karma. I'll use the example of not killing that mouse. It's exactly the same as negative karma, and I'll talk about both. So there you are. In order for an action to be a complete action of virtue, which is one that will sow a seed in your mind that will bring many seeds and eventually bring many fruits of a happy rebirth, there have to be four things in place. Either way, same logic. The first one, there has to be, it's called the object. And in this case, it's a living mouse. This is going to be the good karma, okay? There's a living mouse, the name of the object. The first one is the object, which has to be a sentient being. The second one, number two, is called intention, but it's got three subheadings. The first one is 2A is the word. There has to be, in my mind, a particular state of mind called recognition, which is happening all the time, which is happening every millisecond, or discrimination, they call it. Every millisecond, if we're functioning as a reasonable human being, we're constantly discriminating. I know the couch is there, the table here, there's the cup, there's this, there's red, there's pink, there's white. We're doing it a million miles an hour all the time, aren't we? And that is a crucial state of mind to use for practicing morality. So you have this ability to discriminate between a good action, a bad action, a good karma, a bad karma. If you haven't got that, you've lost the plot, you know. So there has to be, in this case, the bare bones, discrimination. That is the living mouse that I will save. There's got to be that in your mind. Discrimination. That's the living mouse. 2A, 2B, has to be the bare bones intention, which is the thought, the actual thought, I will save the life of that mouse, or I will not kill that mouse. To see, which is the crucial one, which determines the whole flavor of this action, is my motivation. So we could say probably it's compassion, yeah? Unless, of course, I'm attached to eating mice for lunch, and I want to cook it for you later and keep it fresh in the cage so I can kill it closer to when you come home, in which case my motivation sticks, isn't it? For saving the life of a mouse. It's hardly saving the life of a mouse, is it? It would be called killing. And it's even more sadistic. So forget that. But in this case, because it's compassion, then that's, first the object is there, two is there, two is called intention. 2A is recognition, that's the living mouse I won't kill. 2B, I will save that mouse. 2C, compassion is what compels me, impels my thought to not harm that mouse. Then 3, I do the action of picking it up and throw it outside. And 4, the mouse, bye, thank you, Robina, and disappears. That's a complete action of virtue. For a complete action, this brings type of rebirth, they have to be in the form of place. Now, it could be, you can have a mouse in your kitchen. The object is there. 2A, 2 is intention, but 2A is recognition. Well, that's not there because you can't see it. I'll save that mouse, you can't see it. 2B, intention, I will save that mouse. You don't have that because you don't see it. 2C, motivation, you don't have a motivation because you don't see it. So 2 is missing completely from you, isn't it? In other words, your mind's not involved. But 3, your foot stands there and somehow the mouse gets away. So you do actually don't kill a mouse. And it's 4, the mouse, the completion of the mouse runs away. That's an action of not killing, but you. But there's no intention, no mental involvement, so no karma. Zero karma. Comes that. Like the same thing, you could drop $100 on the ground and a poor person could get it. You didn't create any generosity because you didn't consciously give it. So the mind engaged in an action is the potent, powerful part of the karmic bit. There's no karma if there's no mind involved. It can't be. You've got to think about it. There's no drawing the line. You've got to think about it. This is a very different view, isn't it? You've got to think about it. In the Buddhist view, one of the first starting points of practice is to attempt to make the decision, I will not harm any sentient being. And the first reason is for our sake. This is the point that's really hard to hear, because... Are you okay?
Oh, yeah.
You're right? Everything's fine? You're okay? Okay. So this is very hard. The Buddha's starting point, his first level, junior school, entry level, practice is attempt to not harm any living being. This is not easy. Yeah. And but you've got to ask the question why, and this is why we don't think. The reason, he says, first and foremost, is for your sake. For your sake.
Yeah.
No. This is the point. No. That's the point. This is really hard to hear because we don't think of this. We don't think there's a consequence to me if I kill a mouse, do we?
Yeah.
We don't think that because we don't think killing a mouse is wrong, right? So even if we do kill a human, we don't think there's a consequence unless we get caught, right?
Oh, no.
Maybe we sort of think we might have created a sin or something. Yeah. But we don't think it's a sin, if you like, and we don't think it's negative to kill a cockroach. So this is why it's quite hard, coming from a Christian background, where God is said to have made these creatures for our benefit. There's no sin at all. So in the West, that's the view that's informed our science. But the Buddha's view about karma is really powerful. Forget compassion, that's too advanced. He's saying, this is the meaning of karma, every millisecond of what I and you do and say and think sow seeds in my mind that will ripen as my experiences in the future. So now let's get to Vikrant's question. Why you kill the mouse with fear, you kill the snake. So or the cockroach, the same thing. You look at this cockroach, it's disgusting, and we think I must kill it, it's dirtying my food, we think of its virtue. But we've got this is the thing, so let's analyze those 4 points to see what other components going on in that scenario, because then we will determine what the karma is we create, which is meaning what are the seeds I'm planting that will bring fruits to me. It's got nothing to do with moralistic, it's got to do with punishment, it's got to do with reward, it's not got to do with anything like that. Buddha's saying everything we think and do and say first brings consequences to me. Can you hear that point?
Mm-hmm.
Forget compassion here. So let's analyze. Now, well, his point. This is to say it's the mouse. It's a bit of that fear of life, don't it? So let's look at the mouse, okay? So now it's going to be killing the mouse instead of not killing the mouse. The last one was a virtuous action. It's exactly the same logic. The first is that living mouse. Number two is intention. 2A is recognition. That is the living mouse I'm going to kill. 2B, intention, which is the bare bones thought, I will kill that mouse. And 2C, now, is the motivation. So most people would have fear. Most people freak out when they see mice, don't they? Most people do. Some people do. Let's say the fear. But if you analyze the fear, fear, remember, is the main energy in all the delusions. It pervades all the delusions. Because it's what I don't want. That's why we have a panic attack. So basically, though, I would suggest, of the three root delusions, as long as the Buddha talks, you've got attachment, aversion, or ignorance. So most negative actions that all the universe do is for one of these three reasons. Attachment, well, you go fishing, as attachment. You cheat on your partner, as attachment. You rarely kill another person because of attachment. It's usually anger. Aversion, wouldn't you agree? Aversion, anger, motivates most. So in this case, I'd say it's ignorance. Mm-hmm. And if it were ignorance, it would be like you think you'd get enlightened if you kill a mouse.
Aversion.
So in this case, it's aversion, isn't it? Would you agree? It's aversion. Anger. Oh my God, disgusting. How dare this mouse be in my kitchen? That's called aversion. It's called anger.
What if your life is in threat? Like,
just a minute. Wait. So it's aversion still. Even more. Even more aversion. Even more self-grasping. Even heavier. Because it's I, more. It's natural. That's why it sounds so shocking. But it's kind of, we're all like this. We're all like this. That's the point. It's the same. It's even more heavy. Because there's so much fear, there's so much self-cherishing, there's so much, oh my God, that being's going to harm me, you know? So it's kind of interesting. It's even a heavier negative action, actually. Because then out of that incredible fear and rage, and it is rage, you've got to harm that being brutally, isn't it? So it's kind of interesting. So anyway, to finish the mouse one, the second point, which is the crucial one, is your the recognition that's the mouse, the intention, I will kill it, and your motivation, strong aversion, putting in fear. How disgusting, my God, you know. And you could argue there's some compassion there, but not for the mouse, for your children, maybe. And that's the usual reason people most kill people. You know, George Bush dropped bombs on those people because they're harming his people, and Osama bin Laden dropped bombs on those people because they harm his people. So it's only compassion for another group. It's only compassion for the person, you know, isn't it? So in this case, it's huge aversion, because how disgusting this mouse in my kitchen. And aversion is attachment not getting what it wants. I want a clean kitchen. Now, how dare this mouse offend me, basically? It's totally self-evident. So then, the next one is, I kill the mouse, and then the end result, the mouse is dead and I rejoice. That's a complete action of killing.
Suppose you don't rejoice. You get regret.
Okay, there's are variations of it. All there's millions of variations. Of course there are. But I'm looking at the classical example of a complete negative action of killing, such that the four are there, and at least seeds that will ripen in the future, and of course you don't do anything about it. So of course, people do things, and then we have panic, and then we change our mind. So the sooner you regret it, the better. Of course it is. But the ideal scenario, you know, I mean, it's not anything's training. It's just training. It's just training your mind. Right.
Can I ask a practical question of sort of in regards to non-violence? How do you, to you personally, how do you deal with food? Because there's so much. I guess you know if it's well, the way agriculture is sort of practiced in this world, there's so much killing of pests
of course,
and all
right.
to produce the food that we eat. So, you know, one can choose to buy organic when one can. Let's say one is traveling,
organic,
one is a guest.
Organic, but organic still harming so many creatures.
So then how do you personally...
Well,
what
yeah, okay, basing on the teachings of karma.
Just with food. So
yeah, I understand. So taking the view of karma, which of course is the basis I try to use to interpret my life, for my actions. First of all, Buddha would say that the universe, just by existing, it's obvious, we're harming countless sentient beings. Just by breathing, we're harming billions of beings. They're living in our pores, under our arm and our body. By walking, by breathing, we're harming countless beings. Are we not? The Buddha says there's not an atom of space in the universe, you won't find sentient beings. So just by existing, we're harming. This is the tragedy of samsara. So then this is why he says, you can't exist without harming others. So what are you going to do? You have to start with the intention. I will do my best not to harm. And that intention, because that's the meaning of karma, programs your mind into becoming a non-harming person, even though you're still killing Buddhism beings. So this is why even just being vegetarian and vegan is not so good. Not in the end, I'm sorry, is not so helpful to sentient beings. It's good for us because it's, you know, it's good for us because we have compassion, but all the beings are still going to get slaughtered. All those fish are still going to get slaughtered. All those chickens are still going to die. And even, actually, this is an interesting point. I remember someone does a Facebook page for me, Sarah, and she, and I don't, I eat meat sometimes. And, but I certainly eat cheese and milk, okay? I'm going to answer your question fully in a minute. So it was interesting. Some of the vegans and vegetarians get very fundamentalist, I'm afraid. And I think it's based upon attachment to food. We're so attached to food, you know? So this, I happened to send a picture from Liverpool of me being in this amazing cheese shop, and I remember having this kick-ass cheddar or something, and I put it, I said, please. And then I got all these those fundamentalist vegans, how dare a Buddhist nut do this shopping center, really heavy, really on Facebook, so heavy, so critical. And I didn't want to be political.
Yeah, so. Then.
So I didn't want to be political. So what I did was, I researched on Google two different things. How many creatures get slaughtered on the road? You know? So this fellow, that's exactly what he's done this. You've got to find it on Google. Google's incredible. There's this guy in Holland that done some research of just the number of creatures that get slaughtered on the number plate of cars in a certain bit of road over a certain period. And he deduced from this sort of like, quoting in America, must be trillions upon trillions of creatures are slaughtered every day in a tiny period, you know. So I didn't want to be too rude and say vegans and vegetarians drive cars, but I thought it was obvious. I put that up. But the other one I found was really interesting. Some Australian scientist took going on about vegetarians being so, you know, holy. He said, you know, I'm sorry, they probably cause even more harm to some of these sentient beings. So he did this story, he wrote this story about this wheat field in Victoria. The, you know, acres and acres where they grow wheat, and when there's no growing happening, it's taken over by millions and millions of these cute little field mice. They have pictures of the field mice, they said they sing songs, they're so cute. And of course, when they have to come to plant the wheat again, what do? They kill the millions of field mice so the vegetarians can have their wheat. So, I mean, you can't win, you know? This is the point. So, this is what's interesting point. Again, remember, whatever each of us does, first and foremost in here, is the starting point of everything. So the first thing we can do is, all we can do is have the wish not to harm. Now, and think of yourself, straight away, what are you doing to you? Forget the creatures you're not gonna kill, but look at what you're doing to yourself. You're turning yourself into a wonderful person, aren't you? If you truly program your mind with the wish not to kill, not lie, not steal, by living in vows, you might not save that many creatures, but this is at least you getting yourself out the hell of samsara. For next life you're born with no wish to kill. So you've got to see the benefit to yourself of intention, of pure mind, of motivation, that you're the recipient of this. So maybe in the end you don't, there's no creatures that get saved by even if you starve, you've got to be killing countless creatures. So you can't accept that, you have to accept that. But all you can do is have the wish not to harm, have a vow not to kill, help your own mind develop. And then you get more compassion, which leads to part of your process. And on the way, you might just save a few creatures, isn't it? But you make your choices, you know, if you're going to get, you make choices. Because, you know, for you, karmically, it's heavier. It's still the creatures that get die. I mean, you sit in a fish restaurant, and they're still going to catch the fish in the pond, in the pool. Just if you didn't kill it, well, the fish still dies. But at least you don't create negative karma. And of course, if you can, you save the fish as well. So the first beneficiary of vegetarianism is oneself. Then if you're fortunate, you can also save lives. Don't hold your breath. Because the point that's so fascinating about karma is that, like the fisherman, the Buddhist view is the main cause of fish getting killed isn't demand, we think that in the world. It's the karma of the fish. I remember in Maine, I read a couple of years ago in Maine, where they do lobsters, you know?
No, I'm just not going.
Okay. So in Maine, a few years ago, I read, suddenly, out of the blue, four times more lobsters turned up in the water. No one ordered them. It was karma, you know? So all the fishermen initially got excited and caught all the... But in the end, for them, it was bad because all the prices went down. So the Maine government had to do millions and millions of dollars in marketing to sell all these poor old lobsters. So, you know, karma is the main cause. So even if you don't order more lobsters, the fishermen, the habit to kill is so strong, the poor lobsters have the karma to get killed, they're going to just have a glut of lobsters in the end, you know? I mean, maybe. So it's not as easy as just don't eat fish, aren't I special? It's for yourself first, you are the recipient of that. How fantastic. It's compassion, you know? You understand? That's really important. And look, even eating vegetables, look, there's a creature that died. You can't avoid it. But do the best you can. Be skillful.
So karma is inherited, but can be...
What, sorry, inherited? What?
Karma is inherited.
From
who? Well, from your previous life.
Yeah, that's right.
But it can, with intention, be
the purification
transformed.
That's what I'm about to talk about, purification.
So every bit of karma can be...
There's no karma that can't be changed.
Yeah.
There's no karma that can't... You've got to get ahead of the game. That's all it takes over the world. We'll discuss that in a minute. Do you have a point?
Just laughing.
So we do the complete action killing, and that's the complete action non-killing. So the more fear is there, the more you lash out and harm. Of course, it's because of aversion and fear, which is delusion. And the stronger the delusion is, the heavier the action, the heavier the karma. Of course, it is. And of course, the sooner you purify, the better. So purification is a really interesting one. I know, certainly in the Tibetan tradition, it may be in some traditions in Tibet more than others. I know Lama Zopa, right? Our teacher, he says you're insane not to do it every day. Because if there's not a millisecond of the day you're not sowing seeds in your mind, and given that we haven't got great realizations of compassion or emptiness, then it follows logically all the karmas we're sowing are negative to some degree. You understand? I mean, it's very hard to hear this because we seem to think we're such nice people, and we are nice people. But until we realize emptiness, we're still going to be creating karma. Until you cut the root of samsara, you've got to create negative karma. So that's why we have to watch your mind as much as possible. But the purification one is so fast. That's why I'm going to give you the vows to get ahead of the game that way. And then also to do the purification. So the purification practice is really practical. Like all of this stuff, it's about the mind, you know, something mysterious. And it's a really nice way to remember it, is in the context of the... we call it purification, but there's four steps, and it's nice to remember them as the four R's. So the first one is regret. The second one is reliance. The third one is the remedy. And the fourth one is resolve. So let me explain. And it's practical. You know, it's often, we have these formal sadhanas for doing it, that the Buddha's and everything. But if you think of it psychologically, and you really hear it in this way, you can do it in your own way, you know. But it's kind of logical, you see. So the first step, you know, is to regret something. It's like acknowledging that you did it. So the Lamas always use the example, or the analogy, of having eaten poison. Well, believe me, if you don't acknowledge you've eaten poison, you're in big trouble right from there. You know, you've got to first, oh my God, what an idiot, I can't believe I ate poison. And this is why it's a good analogy, because we're so addicted to the guilt approach. You know, I'm a bad person when I ate poison. You don't say that, it's absurd. So a negative action is like eating poison, it's poisoning you. And the one about karma is first so important, like I said, to think of the results for oneself first. Because we won't have real compassion for others until, if you like, you've got compassion for yourself. Whatever we think of doing, say, harms me or benefits me. This is a really important point that I think for us takes time to hear. So the first step is to acknowledge. So you sit down at the end of the day and you acknowledge, you know, this is the things you did that day, bad about my husband and, you know, killed the mouse, you know, or your grandma, whoever you killed, I don't know, whatever. I'm just joking, talking. So then, of course, you think of the things today, because we know we have all these burdens, the fights we've had, the things we've done wrong. It's good to acknowledge them, just acknowledge. First we're going to acknowledge actions that we've done that harm others. In fact, this is a really crucial point for the Buddha. You know, I always quote this as a Jesuit priest friend of mine. And I asked him, tell me the definition of a sin. What is a sin? He said, by definition, a sin is doing what God said not to. And that's reasonable in the Christian religion, isn't it? That's how it is. The Christians, the Muslims, because God's the boss. And I think if we look into it emotionally, that's how we think of negative actions. We think of it as doing something that someone said I shouldn't do. So how do we feel then? We get guilty. You understand? We feel, oh, I'm a bad person. And I think, you know, even if it's really, there's a major point actually. It's a major point. So it doesn't say you're not Christian, but you know, but you're a materialist. You're brought up in your mummy's household, and mummy says, don't do that. You're going to say, being a smarty pants, you'll probably say, why not? But we all know the answer. Because I say so. So our view of morality in the world, and that's why we have so much guilt and neurosis, is it's information that someone else has imposed upon us. So that's why if they don't see us do it, we think, oh great, I got away with it. So Buddha says it's a kind of childish view. But by definition for him, a negative action is simply one that harms another. You know, you look around the world, you do some market research, you're going to find nobody likes being killed, lied to, stolen from, punched in the nose. He says that's what defines an action as negative. It's got nothing to do with the fact that he points it out. But then the interesting other point, which is the point I'm making here, he then says to us, he then exhorts us, you know, don't kill, don't lie, don't steal. And we always assume, well, that's because someone says I shouldn't kill, or someone says I shouldn't lie. No, he's being like a doctor who advises you, you know, don't smoke, Robina, because there'll be consequences for you. So you thank him for his kindness. You don't sort of say, you think you are telling me what to do, which is how we think of morality. We're kind of very childish with it, which is why we like to sneak behind and think we got away with it. It's so bizarre. For the Buddha, it's a natural law, like I said here, that every millisecond what you think and do and say impacts upon you first. So he will say a negative action is one that harms another, but he exhorts us not to kill first for our own sake. Because guess what, Robina? If you kill, it'll harm you. And this is the little list of four things. Why? Because the motivation for killing is never virtuous. That, and you see, that's the point about that little thing about the motivation. Okay, use another example. What's your name?
Kamal. Kamal.
Okay, so let's say Kamal has a mouse in her house. Right? And you see the mouse. There's a living mouse, number one. Number two, intention. 1A, recognition. There's the mouse I'm going to kill. 2B, intention. I will kill that mouse. 2C, motivation. You have compassion. It's possible. It's called euthanasia. Do you understand? You see the mouse, it's suffering, and you think, oh my God, the poor mouse, I must kill it because that will stop it suffering. And that, we know, is a very common view in our culture, isn't it? So, 3, you kill the mouse, 4, it dies. It's exactly the same as his action, isn't it, or mine? But the difference is the motivation. The one piece is different. Everything else is exactly the same. But the one piece, and this is the point about the power of motivation, the reason you do it, that's what determines the karma you bear. So the mouse is there, you intend to do it, you do it, and the mouse dies. Same exactly in my case, but your motivation is the wish to help, my motivation is the wish to harm. That's what makes my action negative, that's what makes your action virtuous. Even though the mouse goes into the lower realms because you didn't see its mind. And that's the only reason Buddha said you shouldn't kill a mouse, because you don't have the wisdom to see the life it'll take in the future. Do you understand? But the point here I'm getting at is the power of the motivation. And it's also spontaneous. You don't question it. That's what causes it to be a good or bad karma for you. So you even kill a mouse, but because you meant well for you, you create virtuous karma. Or at least even don't create negative karma. Nothing to do with the mouse. It goes to the lower realms, the poor thing. You put it from the frying pan to the fire. You didn't make it worse for it, but you meant well. But that's why Lama Zopa says meaning well is not enough.
They have no kill mouse traps. They go in and you can use jars for cockroaches.
Oh, good.
There's ways you can try. You don't know everything, but you can try to get a problem-solving thing.
That's right.
Because they invent things from the desire, so they do have no-kill mouse and rat traps.
That's wonderful. That's great. But the point I'm getting, can you see the point I'm getting here? It sounds extreme to say you create good karma, you kill a mouse.
On that specifically,
because the point about karma. But listen, the point about karma.
So it's like if you found a mouse that was sort of its legs were smashed and you felt it was suffering.
Or what if the mouse you perceived it as suffering, but what if it weren't?
Okay, this is the point. I'm not suggesting you go around killing a mouse out of compassion or anything else. But all I'm trying to point out here is, look, karma is a totally personal, experiential, natural thing that goes on in the mind, whether we know it or not. And that's why we have to know it. That's why we have to know what's going on. Sometimes we say the law of karma, and it's not a big stick that's used to judge, it's not punishment, it's not reward, or you killed your bad, I don't care, you meant well. That's not the point. It's a natural thing. So what I'm trying to get at is this. If a person saw you when you were about to kill that mouse, how would you look? You'd look compassionate, you'd look kind, wouldn't you? There'd be tears in your eyes. Everybody can see you full of compassion. Would that be right? You with me? You see the point I'm making? Look at my face when I'm about to kill that mouse. Angry, bitter, ruthless. You understand? Immediately it's evident what's in your mind. It's evident what's in my mind. That's what creates karma. What your mind does. Do you see my point? But the point is, it's not enough. As Lama Zopa says, meaning well is I've never got to have wisdom. So that's why Buddha would say, don't kill a mouse, because unless you're clairvoyant, you do not know what life that mouse will get, do you? So even though you meant well, and many of the actions we do in our daily lives, helping people, we make a mess, because we have no wisdom.
It's done from ego, as opposed to...
It's done from ego, but often, it's, of course it's ego too. There's no question it's ego, but plain ignorance. You know, I think, you know, I don't know that you're allergic to something, and I try to help you, give you medicine, and I kill you. I just didn't have enough wisdom. I was an idiot. So it's not enough just to mean well. Although still for you, karmically, it's not, you can't say you created negative karma. Even one Lama said, even if you're forced to kill and you don't want to, it's what's in your mind that determines the karma you create. It's nothing, not being judging or rewarding. That's why you've got to know your mind. So I mean, it's not as simple as this, but it's really making an extreme point, you know. Because you really did mean to help that mouse, but you just didn't have enough wisdom to know how to help. Even the law, I think they'd say that. If I did an action that I truly meant well, I would not be penalized.
It's an error.
Yeah, sometimes. So it's this is all the karma is a natural law. So it doesn't mean it's good to go around killing mice out of compassion. No, just don't, please. You have to work wisdom. It's sort of like, you know very well, if like I have a headache and you've got a couple of pills, but you just can't remember which one is a cyanide, I would suggest you don't want to give me your pill. You know, you'd be a bit shocked if you gave me the wrong pill. Oh, I meant well, now I am dying in agony, you know. Thank you very much. So this is, you've got to have wisdom. And this is a really major point in the Buddhist one. And what wisdom is, even relative wisdom, is having some common sense that is not, that is what you get as you give up attachment over delusions. You understand?
Can you go through the four R's?
Yeah. Oh, I haven't finished yet. Oh, okay. I haven't begun. I went back to the other four, which is the four things to be in place. So we'll go through the purification, okay? So the first one is to acknowledge, and it's helpful to start that day, you know? I mean, you know, by the end of the day, sometimes we're exhausted, and all this kind of knotted up inside about things we said or did, you know? So you just acknowledge the things you did wrong. And and this is the point here, this is how regret sounds. Regret sounds like this. You know, I can't believe I did that thing yet again. I so regret having done that, bad-mouthing Vikrant yet again. But mostly that would feel like guilt. Mostly it would be like guilt. I'm a bad person. It knocks us up, you know, and I'm scared. But the thing is, it's got to be regret means, you know what, I regret it, Robina, because I'm sick of this habit. I'm sick of this suffering. And anyway, I don't want the long-term results for my own self, because everything I think and do and say brings my own results. You understand? So it's got to be, we've got to cultivate this compassion for yourself. So let's do the same with killing. I regret killing that mouse, because look at the anger, look at the fear in my mind. I don't want to have the karma be born a mouse. I don't want to be killed by others. I don't want to have a tendency to kill. It's the truth. You don't want to. So regret is based on compassion for yourself. And that doesn't come naturally. You've got to really cultivate that. Because we just end up having guilt, you know? I remember the Dalai Lama was asked one time, oh, I like this very much, what's the difference between guilt and regret? And he said, well, guilt, you look in the past, and you go, well, I did this, and I did that, and I did this. And then you go, and I'm a bad person. Which we love to do, and this is that we are our own worst enemies, you know? Guiltness is so spontaneous, which is anger against yourself. I mean, you know, you did this, and you did that, and you did this, and you're a bad person. That's anger. This is exactly the same, and it's very spontaneous. So we've got to really cultivate this new kind of script. Cultivating, I regret that, because, you know, this is the meaning of karma, because I don't want the negative karmic results. If we take the view of karma, that means whatever I do, which is negative, it's going to cause me future suffering. And I know I don't want suffering. So that's the basis of regretting. Regrets for yourself. Got to be for yourself first. And then, of course, if you're properly Buddhist, you can then go, and I regret anything I've ever done since the beginning of this time to harm any sentient being, period. Because all those, you know, all those karmic seeds, I'm lugging around these bank vaults of these karmic seeds. So the first thing is to regret bitterly whatever I've done in countless past lives that will ripen as my suffering, and I do not want suffering, so I regret for the depths of my heart. It's very important, you know. Then, now you go to the next step, which is, what can I do about it? Oh yeah, sorry, Dalai Lama said, guilt, look in the past, but regret, you also look in the past. I did this, I did that, but then you go, what can I do about it? And that's the point here. I don't want the suffering, so what can I do about it? I've just eaten poison, oh my God, what can I do about it? Rather than, oh my God, I ate poison, I'm a bad person. I mean, what a waste of time, you know. Isn't it? You've got to be proactive. And that's what regret is proactive. What can I do about it? So here we turn, whom can I turn to, in other words? Whom can I rely upon? Reliance. And the second one, that's where we take refuge. If you think about it, Buddha, the relationship we have with the Buddha is like our doctor, you know? So you rely upon the Buddha. So we do this formal practice where we visualize the Buddha in a particular aspect of our beings. But it can be whatever you like. You just think of Buddha, and you're delighted to found the doctor, whose medicine you will take, because you do the work, not the Buddha. You do the work. The second kind of reliance is where now you have compassion for those you harm. You've got to have that. And that comes second. Because they all say you can't really have compassion for others until you've got it for yourself, which is regret. You understand? Which is like renunciation also, which is based on the teachings of karma. So now you think of those you harm, and you really know what, I really think of Vikrant, and I know how my words are so harmful, and I'm really sorry for his sake, and I regret for his sake now, and I must purify for his sake. And then, of course, you think of other people you've harmed. And then, if you can be brave enough, you think of people who've harmed you. And why would I have compassion for them? Because they will suffer as a result of their actions in the future. So you have compassion even for them if you can. The third one is, you turn to the third step, is the remedy. So we have a formal kind of practice where we visualize the Buddha sending nectar. It completely flows through. It's a very nice visualization. And then it drives out all the imprints, like this powerful, blissful nectar coming from him, entering our crown, filling us completely and driving out all the imprints of all the negative karma, of all the negative action we've ever done, like filthy liquid disappearing into space. And it's very nice visualization. It's just using your mind, you know. Your mind does the purification. It's just your mind thinking a certain way. Whatever your mind does, you know, as Lama Yeshe says, your mind create negativity with your mind. Well, you purify it by creating positivity with your mind. You are purifying yourself by thinking like this. So the more you powerfully want this and visualize, purify, the more you do that, because it's your mind, not a secret. So we do a certain practice, as well as a repetition of a certain mantra. But you can do whatever you like with it. You can do a certain prayer, you know, whatever. As the remedy. And the fourth step is the most important, my Lama says. It's called resolve. It's the determination to change. So, you know, if like this is an old habit I've got, being angry at Vikrant, then maybe you don't say, I'll never be angry again, because it's too much. You're lying to yourself. It's just ridiculous. So you be realistic. And we often don't do this. You've got to be really talking to yourself. I find doing this practice, I put it this way, it's like becoming your own friend. We talk to ourselves all the time, but usually we beat ourselves up. We're not being virtuous and reasonable with ourselves. You know, we're cursing ourselves and mad at ourselves and pushing ourselves too hard and too ridiculous, you know? But this is being very reasonable and intelligent with yourself. I really find it's such a powerful practice to do it sincerely. I mean, often what happens when you do religious things, you read all the words, you say it, it's kind of empty feeling. You've got to be sincere in it because you're talking to yourself, you know? Because you're the one who purifies yourself. You're using the Buddha as a doctor, but you're doing the work. You've got to be very sincere. This fourth one's really powerful. So if you've taken vows, you know, you vow never to kill every day, you keep reiterating your vow never to kill, and that strengthens, and that's the power of a vow. You don't just have the vow and forget it. And we all know that whatever your mind does, if you determine to do something every day, that's how you do it. It's like learning. If you play piano every day, we all know you get better at it. But if you vow every day, I won't kill, guess what? It digs this groove in your mind. That's how karma works, you know. It's not mysterious. You dig that groove in your mind. So you vow never to kill, never to lie, whatever. But this other one says, okay, maybe for 24 hours, I will not open my mouth. And you say it so sincerely, then don't be surprised, that's what you do, because you're the boss, you know. And then, as I used to say, you go to bed with a happy home. Makes sense, doesn't it? Purification. Because your mind, you have to change your mind. And this is the one about, I'm saying about karma. Every millisecond of what your mind does counts. This is the part that's outrageous. Every millisecond, whatever your mind is doing at the deepest level, it's constantly sowing seeds. So we better be in charge of the process, it seems to me.
Well, no, that the ultimate, you know, samadha or whatever it is,
suggesting you have a but I'm suggesting you have a misinterpretation of the results. So let me talk about that. Okay. The absence of green on this cup, it sounds ridiculous. But if you do had all your life you've seen green, we fix the problem. What you go is, oh my God, it's not green. Mm. What you just observed was an object, a phenomenon that does exist called the absence of green. What you just observed in that bank account was the absence of $10,000. And is that not a massively big object for you? It's huge, so you get quite a shock, don't you? Okay, Buddha says, for eons, we've been believing in, never mind how it exists, he calls it an inherent I. Don't worry what that means yet. Don't worry about it. We have believed since the beginning of this time in the wrong I. And it causes the suffering and neurosis and fear and attachment and anger and pride and lower realms and upper realms and wars and dramas and endless rebirths. The belief in an I, a fantasy I that doesn't exist. But you believed in something that doesn't exist. So we have believed in this neurotic, mistaken view of I since beginning this time, he says. And it's the belief in this has caused us to create all the samsara, universal rebirths.
And the fear
wait. Let's keep it. We believe in something that doesn't exist. You believe in the $10,000 that don't exist. You believe in the green that doesn't exist. When you believe in the I that doesn't exist. So the first moment, so then what we have to do, like in your case, you've got to first observe the vivid thing called the absence of that thing, isn't it? You got to see it whether you like it or not. But when you first have your first moment of the realization of the absence of the fantasy eye, that's your first moment of the realization of emptiness. So emptiness is referring to the absence of something, not to some vacuous space. Zero to do with that. And this is a massively powerful experiential real thing that happens in the depths of the mind of the great yogis when they finally see the truth that the I that we're thinking is there since the beginning of this time has never been there, never could be there, and isn't there. And that's from the first second of your non-conceptual realization of this emptiness, as they call it, is the beginning of the end of your samsara.
What is there?
The absence of that.
Does that mean that when I accepted indoctrination from my culture, and then I come to another culture or another thing, and then I say, well, that's just one combination of possibilities, not stagnant in that, it could be anything, any way. Is that what it means? Everything's in flux and could be any way, any combination?
Doesn't mean like that word.
What does it mean?
That's what we have to find out. The meaning to take from this is that you finally see for the first time that something that has never existed, that you believed in, something that you always believed in, which has been the source of all your suffering, has never existed, does it?
What?
Okay, sweetheart, you have to hear that point first.
But
you didn't, because then if you did, you wouldn't ask the next question. I'm trying to be rude, but you've got to, that's the first step. And then from there, Buddha says, we cut the root of all the suffering, we cut the root of suffering, we cut the root of fear, we cut attachment, we cut anger. Because attachment is on the basis of believing in this I that you want to try and get what it wants. Anger is the response when attachment doesn't get what the I wants. But when you discover that the I that you thought was there isn't, then the whole thing collapses. Samsara collapses, and you cut the fears of samsara, as they said. You've got more work to do, but it's the beginning of the end of the realizations of nirvana and liberation from suffering. They're the words for it.
What are we if we're not the I?
You are compassion and love and wisdom and bliss and joy and a mind that pervades the universe. When you're fully developed, first realizing emptiness, then removing all the other delusions, then perfecting that, then adding compassion to it, and you become a Buddha, how you be is like this. Your consciousness will pervade the universe, because it's not physical. How can it be defined by space or time or matter? It will be infinitely wisdom, infinitely loving, infinitely wise, infinitely clear, will see the minds of all beings perfectly, and will continue to manifest in bodies throughout universes for as long as time exists, to benefit all these other sentient beings with whom you have infinite connection. That's what a Buddha is.
Would they be able to function day to day in the marketplace?
If you couldn't, then this whole thing is a cosmic, insane fucking joke. I mean, the reason, right now our minds are stuck in this body, isn't it? We can't see past our own nose, we don't remember most of today, forget about a past life. We're full of fear. years of misery, we have a body that's full of shit and junk, we get sick, we die, we have a body. Buddhism is like a complete nightmare we're living in. We just think it's normal life, but it's because of delusions, because of these neuroses, because of this grasping, all these fears, because we're believing in this inherent I. So the eradicating of the belief in the inherent I, the seeing of the absence of this I that we thought we were that isn't, is the beginning of the end of all this suffering. And you become this vast, blissful, clear, wise being who can manifest in any body you like anywhere, as a beggar, or as a holy person, as a snake, as a dog, as an ant, as a human, as a wife, as a husband, as anything, to benefit sentient beings effortlessly for as long as time is.
So we're going from the one to, as if we put everything together, to the all the missing pieces of us to the whole?
What do you mean, like, those words work for you, that's fine.
No, I'm just trying to
understand. No, I can't use those words.
I'm trying to understand.
I know, darling. Just read what is teaching, which you're doing already. I know that.
I'll show you this book.
Sure.
I looked for this.
What's that?
That's a picture where
that's
they say that the kingdom. I traveled to a couple of the Buddhist sites. And this is where the kingdom, they believe, where he left that kingdom. So I've gone to a couple of different sites of his. And I was interested in him, which I want to ask you, because from my understanding of Buddha, is that he was part of this powerful tribe. His father had the prophecy, he may be a very holy man or a very powerful leader. So the father pushed every pleasure he could on the son.
So what's the question here?
To do it. I'm almost there.
Pardon.
So that to me, if I was that person, imagining, trying to understand
it. That's right.
That he got curious of what he didn't have, because we crave things we can't have. But he basically had anything that they were able to give him.
Exactly.
So he became curious of what he didn't have. What's his other stuff? It's just a natural. So when he left with his curiosity, he also had the, how do you say, the presence of, he had a presence of power, because he was given so much, you know, like he expects things. He.
What's it going to do with, what are you talking about? You're telling me the issue of the Buddha, this person 2,500 years ago, right?
Pardon?
You're telling me about the person 2,500 years ago.
My understanding of this, so I'm trying to psychologically understand this. So he leaves because he's curious of what, because he's had everything, so it's like boring. When you have all the cake, you're kind of bored and you want something else.
Uh-huh.
So he's curious about what else is happening. And so I have a question.
Okay.
Part of me thinks he took the belief because he was in Hinduism, that's what he was brought up in.
Right.
He didn't like the caste system, but what if we were just, what if everything is not karma? It's just wrong. And people need an explanation.
Animal liberation.
Liberation. You did something to whatever, liberate more animals. I mean, that's what we're
doing. And also, it's always the learning. And also, one of the things I find very helpful is just practicing it, starting practicing it. I mean, I remember a friend of mine, she was in retreat for many years in this little house up in the middle of the bush out of Big Sur. And she up there with all the, you know, sacks of flour and everything. And one of the creatures that would go in the flour, and they multiply, like some moths, isn't it? Weevils, or some creatures, I forget, some flying ones, I don't remember what. But she had hundreds in her house. Well, she spent weeks. Blowing on everybody's head. That was everybody's burst into tears, I've heard about the kindness. So you just got to calm your mind down, relax, don't panic. If you panic, but just imagine being overrun by all these creatures, you know. Then we have anger, then we kill them, then we get obsessed. Just have to be skillful and calm and clear and try to be compassionate. Try to just, because all we can do is what we do, you know? And try to sort of not have fear of it. It's a sentient being, being a mother in the past, being a human being countless times. You can't use the view of karma to make yourself this more real, even though it's again hypothesis. What else can you do? You know? And then certainly, whatever you're going to do to blow a mantra of it, bless it, try and save it, try and release it, try and do your best, and keep remembering for yourself. Don't think of the creature. I mean, do, but it's you who benefits. You're kind, it's good for you. That calms your mind down. And then somehow, and then the other point that's very interesting is this one. You meet these creatures due to karma with this, personal karma. You know, nothing's accidental. Karma's a natural law. It can't just be random. So you got, you know, hi cockroaches, come back. Welcome home cockroaches, they're my cockroaches, you know. But karma with these sentient beings, they're not in my house. So that's the first point. But the interesting point is, everything's due to your past karma. So if you regret every day, right, the four steps, regretting has one of the particular functions of purifying the kind of karma called experiences similar to the cause. So there are these cockroaches, let's say, eating your house or shitting in your spoon drawer. So you think, I regret from the depths of my heart whatever I must have done to these creatures. That will help purify them harming you. Well, don't be surprised one day they stop coming. You purify the cause. So when you realize that everything is due to karma, by purifying the karma, you change the conditions. So maybe the cockroach will stop coming. Strongly regretting, because you don't want to be, you know, you don't want the suffering. Strongly having compassion, purifying, and strongly vowing not to do again. Don't be surprised they come. I've heard this many times, people say this happens. So just different approaches to it. But it's your own sake. Not the panic, you know. Not the end of the world. We panic. Oh my God, we panic, we freak out, we lose the badge, you know. But don't panic. Be calm, think of it as a sentient being, do your best, blow on it, and try and release it. Of course, get rid of it, you know. And then, of course, it seems practical. You clean up the conditions that would attract it in the first place. Clean the house, put food out, so they don't come. But also, purifying the karma can really help. It's not stop coming. Try it out. It's very interesting experiment. Anyway, what else? Well, come on, let's finish.
Can we do a quick Tara meditation?
We can. All right. We'll do a quick Tara. Close your eyes. Do a quick Tara meditation. Relax. So we think of the Buddha in the form of Tara, female Buddha. This is the Bodhisattva aspect. Blissful green light energy you see in the pictures. A beautiful, like Bodhisattva style, not like a monk style. Radiant, blissful female body. Very beautiful. Green is like action energy. She's radiantly beautiful, sitting in the sky in front of us on a multicolored lotus. Her left leg is drawn in like in meditation, but her right leg is sort of slightly out resting on another little multicolored lotus. And this is her action pose. She's like action energy. She's ready to pop up together with sending beings. She's got Bodhisattva style, beautiful face, very blissful, smiling. Her right hand is holding a blue impala flower. She's holding, her right hand's on her right knee. Her palm is up. And her thumb and ring finger are holding the stem of a blue impala flower that blooms in her right ear. And her left hand is in her heart, the fingers pointing up, and it's holding the stem of another blue impala flower that's blooming in her left ear. And just think, everything's radiant, blissful light. And she's the embodiment of all the qualities of the Buddha, incredible wisdom, incredible compassion. But also think of her as like a mirror image of our potential. So now imagine, this is a short one, imagine from her brow that suffering and all the harm, all the imprints of all the harm we've ever done to sentient beings since the beginning of time with our bodies, totally annihilated. Imagine this, full of this radiant white light. And she sends the white light again, this time these radiant beams of white light from the brow, entering our brow, filling us completely, and this time with this incredible potential, our body being blissful, radiant, light, capable, and only capable of benefiting sentient beings. Imagine that. Only capable of benefiting sentient beings, such that the world sees us, smells us, touches us, tastes us, hears us, will be benefited by the presence of our body. Full of this marvelous potential to only benefit sentient beings. From her throat, she wrote, her passion sends radiant beams of red laser light that penetrate our throat, fill us completely, and purify all the imprints and all the rubbish of our speech, all the harsh speech, the uncontrolled speech that just vomits out of our mouth, whether the person wants to listen or not, all the lying speech, the speculative speech, and all the bad mouthing people behind their backs. All this rubbish, purify every atom of this negative speech that's the meanest time that's harmed sentient beings. Follow this blissful red light. Again, she sends the red light, radiant laser beams that enter our throat and fill us completely, this time filling us with our potential. They call it the power of speech. This marvelous potential, such that any sound we utter, even just saying hello, will benefit whoever hears it. It will be totally appropriate for their mind, full of this capacity for wise, compassionate, appropriate, useful, beneficial speech. Our own marvelous potential, full of this radiant red light. Heart. In the center of her chest, she sends radiant beams of blue light the sky, to enter our heart chakra and fill us completely instantaneously, first purifying immediately, eradicating immediately all the imprints of all the delusions, starting with the ego grasping that's the cause of all the problems, which give rise to attachment, which give rise to aversion and anger, and all the other rubbish, the guilt and of low self-esteem and all the fears, all of this instantly eradicated by this radiant blue light filling us. Again, from Lamatara's heart, she sends the blue beams again, this time filling us instantly with our potential. For what? Well, the delusions are gone, so the potential for infinite wisdom that sees things as they are, bliss, joy, compassion, love, all the good qualities, which the Buddha says are at the core of our being, are what define us. So the delusions are gone, and the virtue is fully developed, there is only bliss, there is only joy, there is only peace. This is our natural state. Full of this marvelous blue light, our own potential. And then one more time, Lamatara sends these three together, the white to the brow, red to the throat, blue to the heart. This time it removes even the subtlest imprints of all the fusions, and now we is to manifest our own Buddha, our own Tara nature. These three together simultaneously. Notice the finish. We now imagine having purified our own minds, Tara absorbing into us. Imagine we become Tara. So what else do we do with the other sentient beings? It's our job. So we just visualize all sentient beings in the universe, all the enemies, all the friends, and all the strangers. There's no fourth category. Right in front of us, our enemies, the meanies, the ones who are unkind to us, maybe the ones we haven't forgiven. Just a couple of sitting right in front of us. Imagine. So now from our hearts we imagine trillions and trillions of tiny green towers emanate out to the front, to the enemies, to the friends, to the strangers, to the side, the back, above, below, pervading space, entering into all these beings, taking away their suffering, giving all their happiness, and turning them into their tower. Just imagine this.
Om Tare Chu Tare Ture Swaha. 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 Jamchor Sancho Rinpoche Makie Padam Kegyo Che
Good, with a bit of fruit, how nice.
Everybody brought something.